Welcome to Church Online, and a special welcome if you're with us for the first time. We gather together in God's love, in faith with the Spirit of God. We gather together as one. My name is Lynn. I'm the minister at Adelaide West and be sharing with you today. Every week we light a candle as a symbol of our virtual gathering as one. And a visible reminder that Christ is the light of the world. Last week, the Synod Celebration of Ministry service was held at Adelaide West, and we honoured the retiring ministers, including the Reverend Rod Dyson, who was a minister here. Congratulations, Rod. And also recognised Peter Whiting for 50 years of lay preaching. Peter was a member here for much of his life before moving south of Adelaide. Peter is still involved in leading nursing home services, to helps as part of the finance team, and comes back once a quarter to worship lead. So congratulations to Peter for 50 years of serving the church as a lay preacher. Annette and her recently retired guide dog are a part of Church Online every week. Last week we were delighted when Annette attended in person so that we could meet Maple, her new guide dog. Annette has recently been on TV in the See Me For Me campaign and continues to be involved in advocacy for inclusion and equity. So a special hello to Annette and Molly and Maple today. This week is week four of a six-week Bible series, The Bible, Just Another Book. Together we worship, where wide sky rolls down and touches red sand, telling their joy in the one who made everything well.
The reading today is 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 to 17. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, sufferings, what kind of things happened to me at Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Jesus Christ will be persecuted, while evildoers and impostors will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In our culture, we don't always like authority. We live in a time when we don't conform. We speak up and assert ourselves. How often have we thought, don't tell me what to do? We've heard that over the last 2.5 years in these unprecedented times. We use the word authority in different ways, both positive and negative. Authority varies according to the context. Sometimes it's who's in charge, who's controlling people. Sometimes it's stamping authority on a game or giving an authoritative performance. So what do we mean when we talk about the authority of Scripture? Says who? The Bible is central to all Christians, the Uniting Church's basis of union. The Church's foundation document says the Church has received the books of the Old and the New Testaments as unique prophetic and apostolic testimony in which it hears the Word of God and by which its faith and obedience are nourished and regulated. Do we simply open the Scripture, read what it says, and take it as applying to ourselves? Where is its authority? If we think of authority as controlling people or situations, then we're looking for authority to regulate, to control. Is that what the Bible is for? Is it there to control the church? But the Bible doesn't consist of rules or regulations, lists of commands to be obeyed, or creeds, lists of things to be believed. It's an ancient narrative text. But how often do we insist that we know what the Bible is saying and that others don't? And hence we become divisive, breaking up into different groups, each thinking that they've got biblical truth right. Some people say they take the Bible literally. It can be a divisive statement sometimes, inferring that others don't. And yet what is taken literally is somewhat cherry-picked. For instance, most of us see no issue with eating shellfish or lobster, and yet that is prohibited in Leviticus. I would suggest that we're all wearing clothing of more than one type of fibre, and yet wearing clothing that blends more than two types of fibre is forbidden in Leviticus. Eating pork is forbidden. Getting a tattoo or getting rounded haircuts, all forbidden once again. And we don't always greet each other with a holy kiss, and that's not just due to COVID. To read something literally is to take the words in their usual, almost basic sense, without metaphor or exaggeration. So if we think of some of the statements that Jesus said, often called the I am statements, I am the bread of life. Without metaphor, that means Jesus is bread or the light of the world. So Jesus is actually light made up of light particles, the gate, the vine, the shepherd. And I could go on, but I think you get my point. With this meaning, I don't know of anyone that thinks these statements are to be taken literally. I personally think the statement taking the Bible literally is unhelpful. It is more helpful to say we take it seriously, seriously enough to read it, seriously enough to read it in its context, seriously enough to consider the three worlds of the text, as we did in the Taking Them at Their Word, week 2 of this series. The world behind the text, the world of the author, the world within the text itself, and the world in front of the text, the world of the reader. You know, we often refer to the Bible as the Word of God. But as I hold the Bible, this amazing book that I live with and by, that reads me as I read it, I don't believe that it's literally the Word of God. If it was, I couldn't hold it. It would burden me. I wouldn't put it on the floor or on the back seat of the car. Literally, this Bible that I hold is printed pages and bookbinding. When I've written all over it and the pages are tatty, I can recycle it. It is pages of paper. The printed Bible is not God's word, literally. Jesus Christ is the word of God. And the Bible points to Jesus, the word of God. Scripture is only scripture. Now, Karl Barth is often referred to as the 20th century's greatest and most influential theologian. He was a pastor and a professor, an outspoken critic of the Nazi agenda, and an influential voice in the formation of the World Council of Churches, which is meeting in Germany this week. Karl Barth said that Jesus Christ is the one Word of God, and the Bible is a kind of mirror of the Word of God, pointing like a signpost to God. He says that God's Word comes in threefold form: the Word preached, the Word written, and the Word revealed or incarnate. He taught that if God's word could be translated into mere words, these words would themselves become our God or our ultimate. But instead, the Bible is the primary and indispensable witness to God's living word. The Bible is a signpost, a witness to the word of God. Now, I know some of us get a bit concerned about saying, "This is the word of the Lord," after a Bible reading. Sometimes we change it. Others don't like it when it's changed to "in this is the word of the Lord" or other variations. Personally, I'm not fussed. I can live with any of them. In many ways, "this is the word of the Lord" is our way of saying this is a true story, or this is God's story to us. Or we listen to these words as part of God's story to us, and so we give thanks. Thanks be to God. In the passage today, Paul is writing to Timothy. Timothy was a friend of Paul's, a missionary partner, a pastor, who became the first Christian bishop of Ephesus. I love the wording here. All scripture is God-breathed. This is more than just inspired. It is God-breathed. Scripture becomes the word when God has breathed life into it by the Holy Spirit. And then they make us wise for salvation for faith in Christ Jesus. And scripture is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. And why? So that the servant of God, God's followers, may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Bible is a signpost pointing us to God and equips us for following God. It has a purpose, a high calling. But we are not to worship the scriptures. The scriptures help us to worship. We worship the word of God we find within the scriptures. Authority is who we look to tell us how to live, to shape what we value and where we put our priorities. Authority is about who do you follow? Who do you listen to? You know, people in our culture will happily follow the teaching of someone like Brené Brown, American professor, lecturer, author, podcast host. She's known for her research on shame and vulnerability and leadership. We listen to people like Brown because they have authority to speak based on their recognition by society as experts. We listen to podcasts and TED Talks, people we follow. And today, people listen to influencers. Who are influencers? They're people with the ability to influence others on social media. They can influence potential buyers or a product or a service. Their influence is measured by their followers. The Australian on Thursday had a front page article on influencers and their wealth and their potential for wealth. You can be a mega influencer, over 1 million followers on a social platform, or a macro, or a micro, which is 1,000 to 40,000, or a nano, which is less than 1,000. They can be bloggers or YouTubers, podcasters, or people just doing social posts. And they are influential. They have authority, because this is a new world. Authority is who you follow or listen to. Make the Bible your influencer. Engage with it with a like. Follow it. Most of all, find the one that it points to. current British theologian Tom Wright says this, that authority of Scripture is shorthand for God's authority exercised through Scripture. Authority is not the Bible itself. It is the one that we encounter as we read the Bible. And so we listen to the words. And the Word, capital W, that is Jesus, the Word within the words. 12 minutes only gives us a cursory glance at this. We could spend hours on this. And if you'd like to delve more, I suggest N.T. Wright on YouTube on the authority of the Bible. There's a lot there to digest. Tim Keller is another one that you could look up. So we continue to journey about the Bible, just another book. We remember that the Bible is not God's story about you, but it's about you finding your place in God's story. To finish, there's this verified story of Karl Barth. Barth authored thousands of pages of theology. It's dense and complicated, and I think I'd need to be a theologian to understand him at times. I've started reading his sermons, but his books, they're another world. One day, a student asked Barth to summarise his entire theology, and this great professor answered with this, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." You know, the Bible is a signpost, a mirror, and a witness to the Word of God, Jesus Christ. Its authority is in the one we encounter within it. In it, we find our story in God's story. We find the love of God for us. Take it seriously. It is God-breathed and useful to equip us to follow God. Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Amen.
A thousand times I have failed, still your mercy lives. Should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace. I'm lost, your light will shine when all else fades. Never end, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Your will my purpose remains, the art of losing myself in bringing you praise. I've lost, your light will shine when all else fades. Never end, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control, consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out.
Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you. We thank you for your great love for us that we read in the scriptures. We thank you for your story that we can encounter, that we can explore in the Bible. And that through exploring your story, we find our own story within it. We thank you that we can encounter you in the scriptures. We're sorry for those times when we do leave the Bible to get dusty, when we discount it as an ancient book, or when we judge others for the way that they approach the Bible. We're also sorry for those times that we say those harsh words, when we don't give others dignity. And we thank you that these things and all our sins are forgiven. Holy Spirit, help us to lean in to the scriptures that are God-breathed. Help us to be taught and corrected. Help us to find your love in the pages. Loving God, we come before you with our concerns and our prayers for the world. We pray for those places where there is war, where they don't experience peace, where families are struggling to just do the normal things of life. And we think of the Ukraine, think of Sierra Leone, Myanmar and other places. Lord, we pray for peace. We also pray for the many people trapped in slavery around the world. And we pray for ways that we can, together as humankind, find ways forward where we value the dignity of others, where people aren't exploited. Help us to rise up and to stand together, to stand against this greed and this evil. Lord Jesus, we have schools and other organisations in the communities where we live, and we pause to pray for them. We ask that you would help us to make a difference in our communities. We pray for schools, students, teachers, staff that are still scrambling with everything that's happening with COVID. And we also pray for the year 12s that are getting down to that nitty-gritty part of their schooling. Holy Spirit, we bring to you the people on our hearts, the people in our lives, the situations we're aware of. And we lift them together to you. We pray for your peace, your love, and your healing power to surround them. We respond to your amazing love to us by bringing our offerings, financial as well as practical, and we pray that you would use them to share your great love to the people in our communities and in the world. So, loving God, we bring you our prayers, those that are spoken aloud here and those on all of our hearts, and pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong.
Thank you for joining us today. We hope it's been useful and encouraging to you. If you would like prayer, please send us an email. We would love to pray with you and for you. We look forward to the next week of our Bible series, To Make a Long Story Short. The Bible is not God's story about you. It's about you finding your place in God's story. But we remember that Jesus loves us. This we know. For the Bible tells us so. May the grace and the kindness of the Lord Jesus Christ, the extravagant love and presence of God, and the fellowship and friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you today and remain with you throughout the week. Amen. Blessings on your week. Every week we light a candle as a symbol of our virtual gathering as one.
Oh, there we go.
That's hilarious. You saw it the moment I did, didn't you?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd seen it earlier, I would have called it. It's going to be one of those days, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, at least the game was a good laugh. That relaxes everything.
Yeah.